Simenon's Maigret, a series of plays based on the novels of Georges Simenon.
I've always felt grateful, Jules, to whatever ministerial deity was responsible, that you were never transferred to the Rue des Saussayes.
Why exactly, Georges?
Because I've never really appreciated the way security chaps work.
Oh, that's an understatement if ever there was one. You know, I once said that security's methods reminded me of a lot of crabs crawling and scratching about in the basket.
I hope you didn't say it to one of them.
Yes, but he'd left the Rue des Saussayes by then. Like so many, he had to leave or face being kicked out. Benoit was his name. Now, that was the one time I found myself involved in security and hence in politics.
The missing report business, was that it?
It was. I arrived home one evening after dinner with my chief and Lucas, Janvier, one of our informal get-togethers, and I was feeling nice and mellow. I asked Louise about phone calls, more or less as a formality.
Maurice Denham as Jules Maigret, Michael Gough as Georges Simenon, and Peter Pratt as Auguste Point in Maigret and the Minister, translated by Maura Budberg and adapted for radio by Frederick Bradman.
And no phone calls, I hope, darling?
Yes, I'm afraid there was one.
Oh, you sound serious.
Well, you've time for a cup of coffee. Take your coat off for a minute. It's only 10:30, and I said I didn't expect you back until 11.
Well, I'm still waiting to hear who it was ringing.
A minister.
A priest? No, of course not.
Point, I think he said. The Minister of Public Works.
That's right. Auguste Point. He phoned here himself.
He wanted to speak to you personally. He asked if I was alone or not, and he said his call was to be kept secret.
Was it indeed? Did he say where he was phoning from?
Yes, a public call box. Honestly, Jules, I could hardly believe my ears. A minister of the Republic creeping out and making a phone call from some scruffy box on the corner of a street.
Well, it can happen. Where does he want to see me?
Well, not at the ministry, but at his private apartment at 27 Boulevard Pasteur. Do you think it's a hoax?
Well, it's a bit out of the ordinary, but it's no hoax.
You'll have some coffee
before... I'll have a glass of slow gin and then I'll be on my way. The sooner this is over, the better.
Can I offer you a cigar, Maigret?
Well, I'd prefer my pipe, Your Excellency, if I may.
Try some of this tobacco.
Oh, thank you.
Look, Maigret, between men like us, there's no point in the usual formalities. I'm in terrible trouble. Nobody knows it yet, neither the President nor my wife come to that. I've come to you first. I know what I'm doing is irregular, and you're under no obligation to help me. Will you have a drink?
Oh, well, thank you, Your Excellency.
Good. I think that the use of my title is not necessary at the moment.
Very well, monsieur.
These are some homemade spirits. My father distills some every autumn. This bottle must be 20 years old. Will you try it?
I shall be delighted.
Do you read the newspapers, Maigret?
No, when the world of crime allows me the time to do so.
Your health?
Ah, thank you. And yours.
This was in the Globe a few weeks ago. I've marked the paragraph.
Will someone one day decide, under pressure of public opinion, to reveal the contents of the Calam report? When revealed, it's likely to bring the government down, some people think. So when will it be published? The Calam report. On what, monsieur?
A report written by a distinguished engineer, Julien Calam, who died a couple of years ago, on the building of the Clairfonds Sanatorium.
The Clairfonds Sanatorium for Abandoned Children.
The same. The place that last winter saw one of our most terrible disasters. A whole wing of the place came down. Do you remember?
Yes, 100 or more children died in there.
128.
Now, correct me if I'm wrong. It was built high up in the Haute Savoie, and there was some disagreement as to whether it was in the right place.
Correct. And how it should be built, the design and materials. Calam was asked to consider the whole question, study the project and the site as an impartial expert, which he did. The report was the result and it was never published.
Now, what happened at Clairfort?
The snow melted early, very early. A subterranean river, it wasn't marked on the maps, but people knew of it, swelled and undermined the foundations of that wing of the building.
They built over an underground stream. Well, who was the builder, monsieur?
Nico and Sauvegrain. Arthur Nico, in fact.
Ah, yes, I have heard of him. It's a very large firm, I believe.
Oh, very. And Monsieur Arthur Nico is a very powerful man.
Now, I assume that the report made by Julien Calame was against building the sanatorium where it was built.
Most emphatically. Mm. And against many of the constructional ideas being mooted at the time, but the report was ignored. I was not in office then, so I have no knowledge of the whys and wherefores of this. And Arthur Nico put his building up.
The report is therefore, Your Excellency, like a stick of dynamite with a slow fuse.
The report is... I'll come to that shortly. Soon after that short but portentous piece appeared in the Globe, I was asked by the President to mount a search for the Calame report within my ministry. Briefly, it wasn't where it should be, in the archives of the Chamber of Deputies. Nor was it within the civil engineering branch, and although my ministry was turned inside out, it wasn't there either. Another glass.
Oh, well, thank you. The taste is very delicate. Mm.
Yesterday morning, a man called Piquemal turned up. He looked like an anarchist with a brown paper parcel under his arm containing a bomb. Actually, he was a supervisor at the School of Civil Engineering, and the parcel contained a carbon copy of the Calame report.
Where did this happen?
Where? At the ministry, in my room.
And were you alone, monsieur?
My secretary, Mademoiselle Blanche, showed him in and then left the room. My parliamentary private secretary was in an outer room where there were various people waiting to see me. Piquemal asked me to open the parcel, or almost ordered me to. I did, and saw what it was. He said he wanted a receipt, so I wrote one out for him.
Where did he say he'd found the report?
In the attics of the School of Engineering.
But hadn't they been searched previously when you were looking?
Yes, of course they had.
Perhaps he'd had it under his bed for years. Is it authentic, would you say?
It was an unsigned carbon with Calame's name and qualifications on the last page with a date. Later that day, I read it through. I'm sure it's a copy of the original report, and it would have caused an explosion if it had been published after the disaster.
Julien Calame prophesied the disaster.
Almost to the fine print.
You kept the report with you?
I brought it back here to this apartment that night. I placed it in the desk over there and locked it. I had to speak to the President, and I couldn't do so last night. He was away, and quite frankly, I don't trust telephone calls, as no doubt your wife has surmised. So I waited until this afternoon when I could speak to him in private. I told him of the carbon copy, and he asked me to bring it personally to his study. I came back here to collect it.
And it was no longer in your desk?
It was no longer in my desk.
And the lock? Had it been tampered with?
I don't think so. See for yourself.
I'm very bad at this sort of thing, but I'd say that this lock could be opened with a decent hairpin.
Now, beside the President and what's his name...
Piquemal? They alone knew I had the report. Do you understand, Maigret? I find myself quite alone. I dare not open my mouth. Who would believe my story? Who would believe that I held the report in my hands? Had it with me for some 24 hours and then had it stolen from my apartment. And there's this. At least three times in the last few years, I've been invited by Arthur Nicou, the builder, to his house in Samoa. Last Christmas, my wife received a solid gold pen from Nicou with her initials on it. I was furious. Wanted her to send it back, but I was told that Nicou sent dozens of such gifts to the wives of his acquaintances each Christmas, and my wife liked the pen, so like a fool, I relented. It would look nice in the press, wouldn't it? Minister's wife received gold pen gift from Nicou.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.